today, actually.
No. Next. In 2 weeks.
Hey, the legend. Gary Black. No, sir, you're on live.
Huh? Right in front of the camera.
I'm talking about you. Wonderful.
Be strong in the Lord. feel like the Lord wants us to do that King of Love song right now. Okay, just hold on to that for just a second. I just feel like that ought to happen. I want you guys to know, I don't know how many of you have been through this. I went through this in Uruguay. There was a time that there was no money left. I had nothing. Have you ever been to that point?
Yeah.
Okay. I know some of you have come out of that point. God has blessed you from that point. You said, I'm never going back there again. And I know God has been good to many of us. But let me just tell you this. I've been in those positions where I had, like Dad in New Hampshire, with $7 in the bank, Sunshine Baptist Church, and the Lord the very next week sent $800 and helped us to go on. There is a brother here tonight that's going through that. So if you, during the offering time, just say, man, I'm going to put $10 in an envelope, and I'm going to write just a need for that brother. Okay, just put that. A need for that brother. Need for the brother that was mentioned. Do that, please, okay? And Brother Earl will make sure that that need goes to that brother. Now, I know that that's kind of difficult, but I don't want to go around talking about him too much, all right? Just the situation is dire, situation with some things that happen, how one thing converges another one, and it's not a responsibility issue, all right? I have had that confirmed to me. It is not a responsibility issue. He just needs help, okay? So how many of you have been there? Let's all consider that and try to do something for the Lord. Let's sing this King of Love. This is fantastic. I want you to listen closely to this song because it goes with the message. This song is so important with the message.
Some are numb by great authority, for kingdoms as far as eyes can see, in royal robes they rule from thrones, waging wars they overthrow the weak, and call it
King is known.
has hated them, because they are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. I pray not that thou shouldest take them out of the world, but that thou shouldest keep them from the evil. They are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth.
Hey,
as thou hast sent me into the world, even so have I also sent them into the world. And for their sakes, I sanctify myself, that they also might be sanctified through the truth. Neither pray I for these alone, but for them also which shall believe on me through their word, that they all may be one, as thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee, that they also may be one in us. That the world may believe that thou hast sent me, and the glory which thou gavest me I have given them, that they may be one, even as we are one. I in them, and thou in me, that they may be made perfect in one. And that the world may know that thou hast sent me, and hast loved them, as thou hast loved me. Father, I will that they also, whom thou hast given me, be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory, which thou hast given me, for thou lovest me before the foundation of the world. O righteous Father, the world hath not known thee, but I have known thee. And these have known that thou hast sent me. And I have declared unto them thy name, and will declare it, that the love wherewith thou hast loved me may be in them, and I in them.
Those were Jesus' words to the beginning. You understand, what we see in the scriptures, I believe, is the church starting at the beginning of Acts. All right, but Jesus Christ with his disciples was doing all the groundwork. I do believe a church needs deacons. I believe a church needs organization. I believe that a church isn't a church unless, by definition, it's characterized as a church. You understand what I'm saying?
Yes.
And so what we get right there is the early part of a church. How many of you have been to a doctor you didn't like? Okay. You've been to the doctor and you're like, okay, you're just going to stick that right in, right? Boom. Okay, that hurt a little bit. Didn't seem like you were very compassionate. I think I'll be finding another doctor. You know what I'm saying? This happens all the time. Big problem is, it happens with churches where people are like, you know what? Our church stinks. I've been to one. Yeah. Well, you wouldn't stop going to a doctor, so find another church, just like you find another doctor. You know what
right.
I'm saying? Why? The church was created by Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And it's a good and righteous thing.
Amen.
But there's a lot of shysters out there. There's a lot of religious freaks. There's a lot of people that are doing wrong. No one's going to deny that. But there's a lot of quack doctors, too. All
right?
And every other kind of profession. So just find the good place that you know they're not stealing your mind, and do what God wants you to do, okay? Invest in that place, but do it in a way that you know you've vetted the place, okay? We already hear, after years, decades, of watching a precise way of allowing everyone to look at the books, allowing every part of this church to be a part of the process. Boy, that's a blessing. Tonight we're going to talk about the inner workings of the church, and how you can be a part other inner workings of the church. We'll be dedicating Wednesday night to that as well. I'm hoping that the vast majority of you will be here at 6 o'clock this Wednesday. Extremely important time. 7 o'clock, prayer and lesson time. Wednesday, 6 o'clock, teaching time to explain the inner workings of our church. We can't know anything about this 400-seat auditorium. We can't know about the things that are going on in Sunday school. We cannot know anything about property management, anything related to the inner working of the church, unless we're a part of that meeting, which is then going to catapult us in Saturday and Sunday and do things that I believe are going to cause us to explode as a church. But it's got to be done right scripturally. I'll show you tonight the Bible with reference to those things. Ushers, why don't you come? We take up our evening offering tonight. What a sweet time it's been already. I enjoy when they do these offertories. Listen to this. When I look into your holiness is what they're doing tonight. As tithes and offerings are taken up, I tell you what, anytime I think about the holiness of God, I want him to be glorified. Are you with me on that?
Yeah,
I want him to be glorified tonight. I'm just thrilled with this great crowd of adults, all the children and the workers and everybody over there with the teenagers, and yet you guys that are 100 years old and older, I'm so glad you're here. How old are you, Gary? How old? 74. Okay. Father, thank you so much for all that are here tonight. I do praise you, dear Lord God. I do believe that Eric looks good for 74. That's great. I just pray, Lord, you continue to give wisdom to your people. Help us, Father, to honor you tonight. May we give with joy. You said for us to give with joviality. And I do ask, dear Lord, that you'll use every single penny exactly the way the congregation decides under your direction. In Jesus' name, amen.
Yeah.
there, sir. And when I'm not there, I pray that you just love him still.
Amen.
And thanks for the time you
had today. In my distress, Lord, I cry to you. My soul is so weary with sorrow. Has the Lord forgotten to be gracious? Has his mercy gone forever? You are God. You wondrous things to your good. Thanks to you that I sing. Your compassion and your mercy cannot be understood. You are God. Like no other God. You are good. Jesus, Messiah, has come to you, offering healing and comfort. With his arms around you, you are safe in his care. He is with you now and ever. You are God.
Thank you.
Why don't you be a part of our group? Welcome over to our group. We're talking. kind of fun you can imagine goes on. But you have to apply just like you are applying for a job. All right? So you take those tickets, and they're just like applying for a job. This is your first choice. This is your second choice. That's your third choice. And you put them in different boxes. So that maybe you say, you know, there are two things under evangelism that I'm interested in. Well, you put them in the two separate boxes in the evangelism category with those four tickets. All right? Number two, if you already have a position from before this week, you can reapply or resubmit a ticket application if you'd rather be doing something else for the next 90 days that you haven't been doing up to this point. You can do that. You can switch, okay? And then in November, I'm saying on November the 26th, you can choose something else. Number three, you with me so far? Say yay!
Yeah.
Say nay if you're not. No. Okay, all right. Listen close and you'll get it. Can't be rushed for it. Okay, look at number three. When you submit an application ticket to a box on one of the tables, you are committing to help in that area of the church. For 12 weeks, you're committing to help in the area of that church, okay? 90 days until when? November the
26th.
Okay, that's the last Sunday of November, okay? Number four. This Wednesday at 6 o'clock, 59 of you will meet with me at 6 o'clock. This is the plan. These are those who are already involved in various ministries of the church. And what we'll be doing in a position in rotatory fund of the involvement in the church is we're going to plan our cheers, we're going to plan our jeers, we're going to plan our silliness, we're going to plan our costumes if you use costumes, you're going to plan candy that you give out to people who try to get them to your table, you'll plan your balloons. I know one person, I won't say who, Robin Pinkeye, is going to be putting balloons on her table, okay? I won't tell anybody, Robin. Nobody knows, Robin, that you're doing that. Okay, very good. And then, number five, this Saturday, we're going to be decorating all of the church to show the various areas of the involvement. And I'm going to tell you this, with 30, 40 people in here, it's going to go like that, okay? It'll probably be right after visitation, right after lunch, from 12:30 to about 1:30 to 2 o'clock. All right? Number six, next Sunday, starting at 8:30 and going until 7:30 p.m., that means, of course, when the building's open during the day, the boxes with slips will be set out still, even if the people aren't around, okay, that are manning those tables. And if you have in the middle of the day prayed about it and thought about it, and you come in early, let's say my mom and dad come in at 4:30, okay? If you come in early at 5 or whatever, and you say, I know what I want to do with my slip, you can put it in there even when nobody's around. So you can apply for your choice position, your secondary position, or your smallest ticket, the third choice. Teenagers, you realize, I told you this morning, have two slips, and children are PG. Parentally guided, okay? Children are PG, they're parentally guided. Explain the involvement ideas then in your page to one another if you don't understand. And if you need me to explain it, I'll be glad to do that. Those 16 things, all right? What is the 17th? Can you remember? There's 16 things here. What is the 17th? Right, non-rotatory, and that means pastor, pastor associates, deacons, trustees, and treasurer, okay? And then number seven and last, after Sunday, after this next Sunday, team leaders will work with applicants to do interviews, okay, with them over the phone and determine who should be where. Now listen, sometimes people will apply for something and they didn't even know they did. And so we need to talk with them to make sure they meant to do that, you understand? So once a month, each of your four teams, what are the four teams?
Evangelism, preaching, intercession,
and communication. So the first Sunday of the month, evangelism is going to meet a little early on Wednesday and make some determinations, do some training, think about things. Wonder what they're up to for evangelism, what's going on when you go up to a door, reaping up, opening up, working up. Preaching, same thing, second Sunday of the month. Third Sunday of the month, intercession. Fourth Sunday of the month, communication. And finally, a master list is going to be compiled of interested applicants and tickets to pray over to find organization. Listen now, by September 5th, it should be all worked out. And the following Wednesday, we'll start with our first team training. Okay? And so every Wednesday, 1/4 of the people on this list will be doing their training. All right? Is all of that clear? Okay. So it's just a little early on Wednesdays. And some may need to do that on Sunday as well. I said, better for me on Sunday. That's fine. We'll work it out. Okay? Okay. Questions? Good. I'm glad. Was that clear? Fantastic. If you have a question, you come talk to me later. I'm going to tell you something. This is a lot of fun, but it's also extremely important for the church because everybody gets their opportunity. They get their opportunity to be a part of things. They get their opportunity to be a part of the fun of being a part of the church. Now, grab your second page, your little page, your half page, and we'll start our lesson tonight. Read with me the title right at the beginning. You ready? The Church That Actually Works. Do that with me one more time. The church that actually works. Go to Matthew chapter 20, if you will. Matthew chapter 20 tonight. And you'll see your subtitle there is How to Make a Good Church a Great Church. All right? How do you make a good church a great church? Well, you don't. God does, okay? And he has to do that through the power of the Holy Spirit. So the church that actually works. And the reason I put that in quotations is because you can use the word work in two ways, right? Oh, this really works. Or you can say, they're actually getting off their lazy backside and doing something. You know what I'm saying? Either way, this is speaking of the church that actually does something. The church that actually works. How many of you want to be a part of a church that actually works? Amen. That actually moves forward. That actually sees something going on in their community that you don't have to be embarrassed about. That you don't hide when people say, oh, you go to First Baptist Church? Right. Yes, I do. Your pastor's out of his mind. I don't know what I do. Amen. Number one, think about this with me. Principles. Greatness comes through service, not through some kind of position. Let me say it again. Let's see close. Kyle. Greatness comes through service, not some kind of position. Do you get that? All right, so look with me at Matthew 20 and verse 28. The Word of God says this. Even as the Son of Man came not to be ministered unto. Who is the Son of Man?
Jesus
Christ. Even as the Son of Man came not to be ministered unto, but to minister and give his life a ransom for many. Who here wants to be known for being righteous? I mean, really, think about it. Who your desire to be known for being righteous? I think we all do.
Right. Yeah.
I think we don't want to be known. Oh, that strong, disgusting person, that guy. Oh, my. No. You want to be somebody that is right before the Lord. You want to be somebody who does purely before the Lord. Look at Proverbs chapter 11, verse 25. Proverbs chapter 11, verse 25. Somebody read that. If you've got it, read it right out loud. Proverbs 11. 25. Do it real loud.
The little soul shall be made fat, and he that waters shall be watered
also. The literal soul shall be made fat, and he that waters shall be watered also himself. In many ways, that word liberal means tolerant. You understand? Not tolerant of sin, but tolerant of people who are in need. You understand? Tolerant of people who are in need. So here's the problem. Jesus Christ sets a child in the midst, all right? He sets a child in the midst of the people. And he says, be like this little kid. And all of them are like, I would never. Because I'm an adult. And many of them had those long phylactery robes, okay? What was that? white robes with little pomegranates at the bottom, little bells. They had little bells on their robes so people could know that they were coming. Oh, a Pharisee's coming. Tinky, 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 tinky. He's walking down the road, and everybody's like, oh, there's a Pharisee. But you know what? Jesus totally changed everybody's mind on this. When he said this, he said, hear this little kid. You see this little guy right here? This little child. Be like him. And here we see in this passage of scripture, he says, be tolerant, for goodness sake. What does that mean? Everybody's like, shut that kid up, for goodness sake. What is the matter with that mother? Does she not understand? Is that a Christian attitude?
No.
No. Our attitude ought to be, I've got a problem if that bothers you. That ought to be the problem. I've got an issue if that bothers you. Now, of course, we all realize there must be decency and order at church. How many of you understand that?
Right.
There must be decency and order. We must be able to understand. Tonight, are you understanding what I'm saying?
Yes. Right.
Have there been distractions?
Yes.
Wait a minute. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yes.
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 Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yes.
Okay, say it out loud then. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yes.
Okay. Have there been distractions?
Yes.
Have you been tolerant to it?
Right.
Yes.
I think we have.
Yes.
In fact, this church is one of the most tolerant churches I've ever seen. And these people would sit down here in the front and they'll just say, I gotta get up and leave, and they'll talk as they're going out. And all of you are just like, man, the pastor's really good tonight. Wow, that's fantastic.
That's right.
I don't understand you. All I know is it's the grammar of God by listening.
Amen.
It's amazing. So why is that? Well, it's because I think a great many of you, if not all of you, have chosen to be servants rather than served. I think a lot of you are like, I'm not going to be a Pharisee about this. I'm not going to make it so that everybody looks at me. I'm not going to make it so that I am the most important person. Return to Philippians chapter 2, if you will. Somebody read verse 4. Philippians chapter 2 and verse 4. How do you make a good church a great church? Well, that church needs to be tolerant. That church needs to be loving. That church needs to have a lack of pretension. That church needs to have an attitude of humility. Somebody read verse 4 of Philippians 2. Read it out loud. Somebody.
Look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others.
Fantastic. So what do? I let the mind of Jesus Christ be in me. Verse 5. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men. Would you not agree with me that if there's anybody ever that existed that had the right to look down on us, it was Jesus Christ.
Right.
Amen.
And as weird as I am, he loves me anyway. With all the eccentricity and all the strangeness and all the ways that I mess up, he loves me anyway. It's incredible. So as you've gone through principles, make sure you write those down. Number one, write this down. Matthew 23:11. Look it up later. We looked at it this morning. Mark 9:35. Look it up later. We looked at it this morning. Proverbs 11:25, look it up later if you didn't see it just now. Matthew 20:28. And Philippians 2:4-7. Philippians 2:4-7 is probably most important. Have the mind of Jesus Christ. Number two, opportunities. 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 Alfred Nobel. Anybody know that name? Alfred Nobel, the inventor of dynamite. You understand it? Alfred Nobel invented dynamite because he thought, man, this is going to be a good way to bring peace to the earth. Anybody that has this tool, nobody's going to want to fight against them. So what does it do? Well, it will queer every battle. People won't want to fight. It'll take away all of the animosity. Well, what ended up happening was just the opposite, just like the atomic bomb. They use it against each other. They prove that humanity is just as vile as the Word of God says it is. Jeremiah 17:9 says what? The heart of man is deceitful and above all things desperately wicked. Who can know it? And Nobel, at the time of just about, I think, early or later on in his life, they got him confused with another guy. Was it his brother? Okay. They got him confused with his brother. His brother died. And they got him confused with his brother. And they made Alfred Nobel's obituary in the newspaper. And he picked up the paper one morning and looked and said, I'm dead. Oh my goodness. Right here, the obituary. And right at the top of the obituary, it said, Merchant of Death. How'd you like to be known as the Merchant of Death? Alfred Nobel looked at that and he thought, I am determined for the rest of my life to make my end to be the Merchant of Peace. And so, he set up this idea of the Nobel Peace Prize. And people were given the Nobel Peace Prize year to year. So what do you want to be known for? Merchant of Death or Merchant of Peace? What do we want to be known for? Dear ones, just blurt it out. As you're looking at Philippians chapter 2, you're there still, right? Look at verse 3, won't you? Read with me Philippians 2 and verse 3. What does it say? Read it with me, right out loud. Let nothing be done through strife or vain glory, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem others better than themselves. That ain't nobody who bought that dress. That's a stupid dress anyway. Honey, could you just put a sock in it for a minute? Hey, I'm trying to study here. Merchant of Death. My friends, words we say are as if we're killing people. We've got to get to a point where we understand words are important. Amen. And if I'm not going to take this verse to heart, I might as well quit my Christian life right now. Let nothing be done through strife or vainglory, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem other better than themselves. Now, can you connect to this? Well,
careful.
Sorry. Can you connect to this? This is becoming a comedy routine. Okay. Can you connect this with verse 5? Can you connect this verse with verse 5?
Yes.
I'm going to trip over that again. I'll bet you. Look at verse 5. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. How do you get the mind of Christ? Can you have the mind of Christ without receiving Jesus Christ?
No.
If you have never had the experience of sitting down and praying to God and honestly meaning in your heart, God, I am leaving my sin for you. I am turning from that. Now, from this point on, I can't do right. I've tried 1,000 times. There's no way. Will you please change me? And then step by step, allowing the Holy Spirit to put into you the fruit of the Spirit. Over the years, not going to happen like that. We talked in Sunday school about various sins. And I said to them, what is repentance? And we talked about repentance. And then I said this, if that's repentance, and repentance is a part of our experience in getting saved, in coming to Christ, and making ourselves dedicated to Him, to allowing Him to change us, then if you're still sinning after you're saved, were you saved?
No.
And they went,
Yeah.
Can I tell you something, my friend? There are a whole lot of people who 2, 4, 6 years after they got saved still struggle with smoking.
Yep.
They still struggle with cussing. Yep. They still struggle with illicit thoughts. They still struggle with alcohol.
Right.
They still struggle with thinking about the wrong sex even. Listen, my friends. What the Bible calls sin is sin, period.
Yes.
But He is gracious enough to give you time to make those changes. Will you ever be perfect?
No.
I am so glad you said that, because I've been at this game for 34 years. I still am a real dummy, you know what I'm saying? I mean, I still have, and 43 years of being saved, and I still sin all the time. Dad, have you ever seen me sin? Are you pointing to yourself? Yes, Dad does sin more than I do. You're right. We all have to look at ourselves. That's what Dad is trying to say. Romans chapter 2 and verse 1, if you will. Put that up. Romans chapter 2 and verse 1 says this. It says, when it talks about judging, therefore thou art inexcusable, O man, whosoever thou art that judgest. For when thou judgest another, thou condemnest thyself, for thou that judgest doest the same thing. I just wish she would put on a better skirt. That does not work for her. And everybody's thinking the same thing about you. See what I'm saying? Why? We judge one another. Horribly we judge one another. So get this. Molds. How many of you know what a mold is? Okay. Awareness is key. We all tend to tunnel vision toward our own needs and desires rather than looking outward. We start to think, man, I need this. I want that. Boy, if I had the opportunity to do something in church, I'd be the pastor, you know? I mean, whatever it is, that desire that you have may not be the desire of God. So what do you got to do? Let each esteem other better than themselves. Verse 5, what? Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. What are we going to do if we're going to be a great church for God? Look at Matthew chapter 25 and verses 34 through 40. Matthew 25, what does the Word of God say? Matthew 25, this is a great text. Oh, God is so good to give these things all together. In verse 34, you're reading this. Then shall the king say unto them on his right hand, come, ye blessed of my Father, and here the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. I was hungry, and ye gave me meat. I was thirsty, and ye gave me drink. I was a stranger, and ye took me in. Naked, and ye clothed me. I was sick, and ye visited me. I was in prison, and ye came unto me. If you've done it unto the least of these, you understand what the text says. You've done it unto me. What do you do? Number one, you've got an opportunity here. Write it down. Your opportunities are these. Looking back. Write it down. You got it right there on your page. Looking, and you can write it in. Looking back. Number two, looking around now. And then last, looking forward. What are you doing? You're evaluating what you've done. Do we need to do that? Have you evaluated your life? You ever sit down and go, oh man, I got some changes I need to make. You know what I'm saying? Sin, right here in the middle of my life, right now, looking around me and noticing where I'm at. And then finally, looking forward in anticipation. Matthew chapter 25 was written so that we would look out from ourselves and find the need, the opportunity. This church was built so that you could show your love for Christ. A whole lot of people say, I go to church because I need. What? We go to church because everybody else needs me. Do you get that? People don't get that anymore. They don't understand what church is. Church is meant for you, for me to minister to you. You say, well, then why am I sitting in this pew? I don't know. Why? Go win souls. Go do right. Yes. Go feed the poor. Go help the lost. Go be the solution. Not right now. Not right now. Just wait a second. Just wait a second. Stay right where you are for a minute. But the opportunities are these. Number one, feed the hungry, the word said. Refresh the thirsty, verse 2. Hospitality. And you'll see, this deals with the body, soul, and the spirit. Hospitality, short-term, long-term, permanent housing, clothing, needy behavior, caring for the sick, visiting the imprisoned. Now, am I talking about physical needs? Good girl, Louise. Wow, you're really paying attention now, aren't you? Good job. Hey, listen. Soul and spirit means if you're thirsty in your soul, you need somebody to minister to your innards, not your outers. You get me? So it may be that you're feeding the hungry soul. It may be you're refreshing with great water of the Word. You know, the Word of God says that we are part of the process of the washing of the water of the Word of God. Have you done that? Do you do that? Do you visit the imprisoned? Do you help the needy? Do you care for the sick? One day, Jesus Christ will look at a group of people. Look up here now. Look. One day, Jesus Christ will look at a group of people and say, you fed me when I was hungry. You housed me when I needed housing. You gave me clothes when I was naked. You gave me drink when I was thirsty. And that group of people, whoever they are, will say, when did we do this, Lord? Right. And he will say this, if ye have done it unto the least of these, ye have done it unto me. So if you're truly saved, the marks of a true Christian will be all over you. And the marks of a true Christian are not to get up on Sunday morning and come to church for an hour. I wonder when he'll be done. The marks of a true Christian, a godly Christian, are 24/7 hour a day, week, day, seven, all that good stuff. It's all that good stuff. All week long. Stop making fun of me. All week long. For Christ's sake.
Amen.
That's a true Christian. And they think about it while they sleep. My wife thinks about stuff. She thought about things related to my mom and dad. She makes me hurt inside for being so selfish. At times my wife, you know, think about this. How would it be for you to take in 6 adopted kids?
Right.
I mean, that was all her. It's her nest. We had this talk. Where's Brother Gary? Brother Gary around? We had this talk with Brother Gary while he was here. Must have gone to the other part of the building. We had this talk when Brother Gary was here in our house. And he said, you know, when I was a kid, they didn't let you in the kitchen. Right. I was like, hey, listen, you stand right there. What do you need? This is my place. You know, the mama in the home, she's important. So what do? Act like that child with God and realize his place and your place and let the greater opportunities that are available to you be given to you rather than trying to take them. Mm-hmm. So everything at church is at your disposal. You've got this massive supermarket of involvement and you're like, man, it's going to be fun. Hey, just let me go. Supermarket sweep, baby. 1, 2, 3. No, all week long, take that page, all week long, yeah, you put too much in that pocket. All week long, take that 16 bullet point page and plead with God about where you'll be involved. And don't go buy rice, okay? Go buy a hot dog. Whatever it is precisely God wants for you to consume and use for the good of others, do it. Number 3, initiating under God's guidance and direction. This is how you get initiated. This is the way. Walk in. This is the way. Walk in. Psalm 32 and verse 8. This is the way and walk in. Psalm 32 and verse 8. You see right there on your page, initiating under God's guidance and direction. You see that upside down triangle there? The upside down triangle represents this. That point at the very bottom, right there on your page, you got your page? Yeah. That point right there, that's Barry Seacrest. Everybody else is up here. So the pastor's down here. The deacons are up here. The trustees are up here. And all the way up to the smallest child who is the most important in this building. That's what Jesus Christ's mindset is. I am last, everyone else is first. Well, then why are you in the pulpit? It's because this is the back of the building. Hello?
Amen.
There's one. Good. I praise God for being in the back of the building. Let me give you five ways to serve others. Look at this real quick. Five ways to serve others. You'll see this. Time, all T's. You see the five? Five ways to serve others in the middle of your page? Time, talent, treasure, talk, and testimony. Time, talent, treasure, talk, and testimony. My friends, that's where we're going to be going this evening. On Wednesday, we're going to deal with 4, 5, 6, and 7. But these three things that we've spoken of tonight are valuable. Why? What do they speak of? They speak of the power of positive thinking. After, we got to be positive. Because I tell you what, I've read the book. Power of positive thinking, you can take and just flush right down the. All right? Just get rid of it out of your mind. Don't think that. There's nothing good in you. Nothing. But the power of positive. I think about this. What did I say this morning? Do you remember? What?
Expectation.
Yes! The power of positive. Okay, four have said it. Let me see. The power of positive
expectation.
It's getting better. The power of positive
expectation.
Now, what does that mean? It means God expects great things from you. And He's the greatest power there is. So if He can expect a how all the way across the room to Brother Earl, to Andrew, to Brad, to Julius, if God can expect the greatest from you, Oscar. The greatest you can give. God can expect that of you. The power of positive expectation. Why not give it to Him?
Amen.
Would you bow your heads and close your eyes? Think tonight. Have I even received Christ? I don't know if I have. Am I sure I'm really saved? I mean, I played a pretty good game, but I don't know if I'm really saved. My friends, hell is not a joke, it's not a story, it's not some artfully designed way to make little kids behave. It is the truth. I've studied it for years, it is a reality. There are only two places you can end up, and that is heaven and hell. There's no purgatory, that is a fairy tale.
Yeah.
There's nothing in the scripture at all, anywhere, that even uses the word purgatory. In the Holy Bible, the scriptures, the only scriptures of God, you find hell spoken of by Jesus Christ, one-third of His ministry. And the other two-thirds are things mentioned on how to get to heaven. My friends, Jesus says this, you must admit you're a sinner. You must believe Jesus died on the cross for your sin and rose again. And then you must confess before Him in repentance that you can't do it on your own. He's the only one that can say, oh God, take me. And then on a daily basis, living for Him, loving Him, doing His will. There's someone here that say, Pastor, I'm going to be honest with you. I'm not 100% sure I'm going to heaven. That kind of scares me. Slip your hand up if that's you. I'm not really sure. I mean, might be 95% sure I can start with that. Slip your hand up if that's you, dear one, please. Please, anyone? Please, please. Certainly is important. If you need to, just talk to Him right now. Say this, dear Jesus, I don't know if I'm saved. I need You. Would You please save my soul? I know You died on the cross for me. I know Your blood cleanses sin. I know Your Father raised You from the dead. The best I know how, I give You my heart. Save my soul. I want You to make me right. Because I can't do right without You. Help me. Thank you for saving me. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Word of God says this: anyone that will come unto me, I will in no wise cast out. He says in Hebrews 13:5, you can be content with such things as you have, for he has said, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. John 10 and verse 28 says, my sheep hear my voice, and I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish. You know what? My God tells me in 1 John 5:13, these things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that ye may know that you have eternal life. So when people say to me, I don't know, I say, you should. Read your Bible. These things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life. Is there someone here that doubts at all? Listen, let's stand together right now, make it easier for those that need to come. If you need to come down this aisle and get right with God, do it now. If you need to come down this aisle and talk with a counselor, do it now. If you need to come down this aisle and pray for the lost, do it now. If you need to come down this aisle and be baptized, do it now. If you need to come down this aisle and get a hold of somebody, go ahead and do that. Barbara, honey, please. If you need to pray for somebody in your area, someone around you, do it now. Hey, pinpoint if someone around you isn't saved and be bold enough to ask them. We don't have time. Be bold enough to ask them because we don't have time. Let's make sure people know Christ. Let's make sure our friends and neighbors know Christ. Are you praying for your friends? Are you praying for your neighbors? Praying for such as kind? Why don't you get right down your face right there in the pew, or come up to this old-fashioned altar and just beg God for those that are in need. Are you saved? Don't mess with this idea, oh dear ones. Please, I plead with you, don't mess with God. It's as real as I'm standing here. Don't push away the conviction of the Holy Spirit that you're feeling in your heart right now. Don't push his hand away. Don't say, listen, I'm all right, I don't need to do that. Oh, my friends, the Word says, if you won't confess me before men, I will not confess you before my Father which is in heaven. Confess before him. Get right with him now. Anybody? Come on. Come on. Anybody? I love you. I love you. You're allowed to go on, but you certainly are allowed to stay and pray if you need to. Come on down if you need to pray, okay? Come on down.